It's Chris Fade and Caroline Stabry's Not So Epic Podcast.
Brought to you by NMC Healthcare and Cosmisurge. Head to cosmisurge.com.
We're back again. It's Chris and Caroline's Not So Epic Podcast. If you've got us on Instagram, whatever it is, Spotify, Angami, YouTube, thank you for following. Thank you for subscribing. We love getting your messages and keep them coming in at Chris and Caroline on the gram. I'm excited because when was it? A couple of days ago, I get this WhatsApp and I actually ended it by, are you drunk?
He always asks me if I WhatsApp him at night and I deleted one message. I can't remember why. And he goes, oh, you're drunk. I wasn't drunk.
Because you gave me these headlines. We said, oh my God, I've just met the most amazing person. And then you started rattling them off. And I thought, wow, this, yeah, if he can come in, would love to have him on. What's going on?
So, really good girlfriend of mine, Galila Puck, who is like amazing. She's obviously part of Wolfgang Puck, the restaurant. And she built like a huge empire. She's an incredible woman. Okay. It's a fantastic charity that I support as well. I've got to remember the name.
Dream of Future Dream Africa of, Foundation.
Yes. Yeah. Who's amazing. And anyway, so she called me up and said, I have a friend coming to Dubai. Would you like to take him out? And any friend of theirs is always going to be a friend of mine. And I know she knows everyone interesting and there's never a dud. And so I said, sure. So she, you know, before I'd even finished my sentence, I'm on a group chat with him. And which was, you know, and we're going for dinner. So anyway, I planned this big dinner and turns out he actually knew some friends of mine and he was at the dinner. I planned for Friday night and we were already, unbeknownst to us, having dinner on Thursday night.
Okay.
So I managed to cancel the other one. We canceled the other one, off we went. And I got to talking to him and his opening line where I said, what do you do? And he was like, well, you know, well, what did you do? He's in a rock band, discovered by Kanye, signed by Pharrell. Oh, I can't remember now. There was so many things. And I was like, hang on a minute. I'm like, just those two names. I was like, okay, I've got to call Chris.
Harvard.
He was at Harvard. Harvard educated. As I said, discovered by Kanye, signed by Pharrell, in a rock band. I was like, this is genius. And I want the rest of the story. But I was hoping he'd give it to us today.
And you know what? It's going to happen today. D.A. is in the house. Thank you so much for coming in. We appreciate it.
Thanks for having me.
So this is, I was really intrigued as well when... Caroline told me the story. So
it sounds ridiculous. It sounds like he was drunk.
Yeah. He's a compulsive liar. He's made it all up. It's not real.
Yeah, guys, I'm actually just an accountant visiting Dubai for an audit.
Imagine.
Yeah,
exactly. Imagine.
I believe the rock band.
Enjoy your show.
Yeah. So tell, how did this all happen? Tell us a bit of the DA story.
Well, you got a bunch of it there. I grew up in the middle of the U.S. in Wisconsin. And went to Harvard as an undergraduate. And then freshman year, I met some friends and we started a rock band. And we realized pretty quickly a lot of our classmates were gonna go off and be investment bankers, do these boring things. We thought, what could be better than being rock stars? So 100%.
Were your parents disappointed you went to Harvard and wanted to be a rock star?
At first they were.
Yeah.
And we thought, you know, we got to give it a shot. We got 4 years. It's freshman year, we got 4 years. And if we mess this up, we'll do something else.
Sure.
And as Caroline alluded to, just before we finished school, Kanye got our record and called me on my cell phone. I'm in the dorm room and he calls me and he said, Kanye West. And I almost dropped the phone. And then he said, you know, if you guys can come out to Los Angeles this weekend.
Did you at all think it was a prank?
Well, after a minute, I realized, wow, this actually is happening because we used very crafty tactics to try and get our music out there to people in the record industry.
Yep, yep.
In Kanye's case, we had found out about a guy who actually designed his websites, who was a radio dude in Chicago. He wasn't on air, but he like worked at a radio station in Chicago, and then he designed websites on the side. And Kanye was from Chicago, so somehow they'd met. And I said to this guy who I emailed, you know, if you like our record and you give it to Kanye, I won't tell anyone that he got it from you.
Okay.
If you give me Kanye's email address, rather. And he didn't give us Kanye's email. He gave us the manager's email. So I sent that guy an email and I said, look, we've just been offered all these record deals, which was totally fabricated.
Lie.
If Kanye were interested, we'd hold off 1 week.
Oh
and the
gosh.
Next day we get this phone call. So, I mean, it was surreal. And then we went out to LA. I finished an exam, moved out to LA, or didn't move out, just visited for the weekend, my bandmate and I. And we had an incredible time. We went over to his house. We went and had food.
Are you friends now?
Well, friends is an overstatement.
Right.
We see each other from time to time because we both live in LA still. Mm-hmm. We have a lot of friends in common. Originally, I think he was a little disappointed because we didn't do the record deal with him. We subsequently met Pharrell and ended up working with him.
Oh, wow.
And so it was...
Because there's not many people that you would turn down. Like, as in, turning down Kanye is a big move, but then when it's Pharrell, you're like, hold on a second, there is a reason maybe Kanye got turned down.
Pharrell better? I don't know.
Okay, I'm not in the music business, but if I know radio, and if I was given the option and I had to choose, I would choose Pharrell. Only because I've interviewed both Pharrell and Kanye, and they're both very, very cool and both fantastic. I just feel like, from a business point of view, I feel like Pharrell sort of has that. Not that
Is
Kanye
that why you
doesn't,
did it?
But with Kanye right now, I just wouldn't sure. If this was wrong, I just wouldn't know what was going to happen. Like, he could fire me in a week later, and you'd just be like, well, yeah, that's Kanye. With Pharrell, I feel like there'd be a little bit more there. Hey, I could be completely wrong. What was the band's name?
Chester French.
Oh my gosh. Okay. This is super cool.
And I think that was part of it. You know, they're both producers, but really Kanye is the artist himself.
Yes.
You know, he's the personality. He likes the limelight. He wants to make the decisions. Pharrell is really good at figuring out how to bring out the best in an artist. And if you look at his track record, from Britney Spears to Justin Timberlake to even what he did with our group, you know, I think he knows how to inhabit someone else's, you know, headspace and figure out how to position them very well, how to bring out the best in them. That was what we were looking for. And he's just a great mentor.
And what happened?
So we did this record deal with Pharrell. Then as soon as we graduated, we moved out to LA, and that kicked off a real career touring and putting out records. And so for about 3.5 years, we made a series of records. And we went on tour with everyone from Lady Gaga to Pharrell to Weezer, Blink-182.
Is that amazing?
Yeah, that's such a cool
story.
And
it was surreal. I mean, it was super fun. But the record industry...
I know
industry,
the guys from Blink-182.
Oh, you do?
Yeah.
Yes, she shows me their inbox messages.
Oh, they're so great. I mean, Travis Barker was like one of our early believers.
He's the nicest guy
ever.
Let's just clear that up. I don't show him the inbox messages. I showed him one because Travis very sweetly has... What are they called? He has a pop made of his face.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and he wanted to send my boys one. So,
oh, wow.
Like,
no, she doesn't show me the messages. I wasn't saying it like that.
Oh, yeah.
She shows that she has messages from these people.
Oh, that's what I mean. Okay, that's better.
It's impressive.
Yeah.
I think you got messages from a lot of people, Caroline.
She's the most, honestly, we'll go out sometimes and I'll be like, how do you even know this person? How do you even, it's crazy the amount of people that you know Caroline Stanbury, honestly.
Which is... You were less grumpy.
She loves me. So then you did you get your degree at Harvard?
I did.
So you completed that. So the family.
What was it in? Sorry.
It was in African American Studies.
Oh my gosh! So you completed that. Didn't use any of it for a while, I'm guessing. Were you just concentrating on the band from
there? Still haven't used it.
You still, okay, yeah, fair enough.
But yeah, we were concentrated on the band, and then the music industry that we entered was a fraction of its former size. You know, the internet had basically destroyed the music business and no one was paying for music. And so as an artist, I was always trying to think about where there might be opportunity there. How do you fix this broken system? Mm. And 2010 was sort of my next big break. I got really lucky and I learned about Spotify. And at the time, Spotify was just in Sweden and it was relatively small. And I knew enough about the music business that I appreciated this had a shot at revolutionizing the whole industry.
Please don't tell me you invested in Spotify.
Yeah, so I flew over to Sweden and I said to the guys who founded the company, look, I'm going to give up my music career if I can be a suit, if I can be a part of this thing and making this work. Because I figured, look, you can either put out 12 songs every 2 years or you can work for a couple of years on trying to change the whole system. And so Spotify was my first project in business. It was my first investment. It was the first thing I did in technology. And thankfully it worked and took over the world. Yeah. And so Spotify got me into tech investing. And now 8 years later, that has taken over my life, and I basically became an investor.
So you're an investor in Spotify. So like, wow.
She's trying to work out how much money you got. Yeah, that's what she's trying to work out.
How rich you are right now. But I'm meeting my husband.
Well, you want to know how many more meals I get with you?
Yes. Well, free tonight.
Well, so you now, the music is sort of, you know, it was there, but now your whole work and the business that you're into is investing in tech.
I mean, music just became a hobby, which was actually where it always belonged in my life.
Yeah.
If I go back to high school days, when I started really making music full time, and even in college when we started the band, it was super fun when it was a hobby and we kind of did our best work because there was no pressure. When it became a job, it was so intense, right? You felt this pressure to make music that was commercial, not just to express yourself or to do the best thing you could do. And so when the investing became a big part of my life, the music actually became way more fun. So it's still a hobby, but I don't think of it as a career.
So you're married to a, like, you know, your girlfriend is pregnant currently. Is she like a Victoria's Secret model for me? Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Well, she's very beautiful. She and I, it's a funny story. You know, when I got this record deal, I finished college. I was 21. We moved out to LA. We had all this money. We
together.
Were in the perfect place. No. Just me.
Okay.
Just me and the other guys in my band.
Sure. Yeah.
And we got out there and I thought, this next decade, all these ladies better watch out.
Yeah.
Because here I come.
Yeah.
And 3 months later, I meet Liz,
that's
who
crazy.
Now is my wife.
That's amazing.
We've been together for 12 years. We got married 4 years ago.
So cool.
And as you mentioned, she's having a baby and she's wonderful. So
that's amazing.
Yeah.
What a great little, like, I mean, I don't think you're too old. I don't know how old you are.
Dude, but he held her over here.
Yeah, I know.
I'm 34.
34 years old.
Yeah.
Gosh, already done all this.
I know, look.
So when you're looking to invest in a tech, what are you looking in? Like, what do you look at? Like, how do you come across these things? You know, I always hear the stories about, oh yeah, this guy invested into this business. I'm like, how did you even know about it? Like, is it advertised in the
Let me put something in perspective. Chris knows nothing about nothing. Yeah. So what happens is,
I don't,
like,
believe that.
No, but
okay.
Truly.
Okay.
So what happens is,
I play dumb.
Oh, yeah. Okay, got it. I play dumb.
You say anything.
Yeah.
So like, Chris is now going to be your best friend.
Yeah.
He will be on the phone the whole time. He'll ask you whatever investment you're taking. He doesn't care.
And I'll just follow you.
He's all in.
I'll just follow you.
He doesn't with me the whole time. It's like, I don't know. You say you're going to go in sex toys. He's like, okay, was there any money in it?
Stop that.
And it's true. Yeah. And I'm like, do you know anything about
it? Well, he knows there's money in that because he's buying them.
Yeah. Why not?
Buying all of them.
But she's right. If I feel...
But yeah, like with me, if I said that I was going to invest in anything,
right,
he'll follow me.
He's all over it.
Yeah,
all
I'll
over
be like, it. How much you need? Let's go. I'm ready to take that risk.
He's like, I love it.
So
I'm
like,
ready.
Honestly, he's not as poor as he looks. He could follow you.
do I look poor?
Yeah, I don't know.
Better be lucky than smart, you know?
I invested in my first tech company. And what it is, and tell me what your thoughts about this, because I'd like to get your thoughts on it.
We'll do Shark Tank.
Oh my gosh, this is great. So it's called Enhanced Fitness.
Okay.
I've told you about this. We are the Uber of personal trainers. It's right here only in the UAE right now. We will send personal trainers to you wherever you are, at the workplace, at any time. We have our own gyms that we've got deals with. So you can train. You can train.
I've just got up in the middle of a meeting.
Yeah, no.
Like,
can I get one right now?
What? You can get on it right now. They can come to your house.
I would like to train with you guys on air.
What?
If possible, I'll train with you guys on air.
We can do it right now. Yeah. We can find out if there's one here.
This is great.
Stop laughing at my investment.
Ridiculous.
It's not ridiculous. Okay. So we started off when
he's going to be laughing suddenly, all the way to his yacht.
Yeah, do you suddenly panic train?
What do you mean?
Shit, I've got a train right now.
No.
Give me a trainer.
Yeah.
So we're more competitively priced than trainers that you'll find inside a gym. We have our own deals with gyms across the country.
Okay.
So if you're not a member at that gym, it's okay. You hire one of our trainers. We'll take you inside that gym and you can train, right? We'll train you in the office, in a gym, in the beach, outdoors, you name it. We've got you there. Honestly, I've trained in a really small bedroom. We started off at five
not that
trainers.
Kind of training.
We did.
He has
yeah. Have you?
Yeah. Yeah.
You got a baby on the way. we started off at five trainers. We're now at 22 trainers. We employ 22 trainers. They're on our visas here in the UAE, which is important. When you when you move to the UAE and you want a job, you got to have a visa here,
okay,
right?
What do you think of this?
So are they full time employees?
Yes. So the way that it works, because people have tried to do this, but what ends up happening is that after you make make a relationship with your trainer, you're like, I don't want to use this app anymore, yeah. Mo. Can I? So what we've done is now that they're on our visa, they're on a salary and they're on a commission base and they're given housing and they're given car and they're given all the little extras.
So they're like indentured servants. Okay.
Somewhat.
I like
You know what I mean?
I so like it.
And before I invested in them, I spoke to a lot of the trainers that were already there to get their opinion on the company. And you know what? They love it. And we've got all the same trainers we have for the last year and a half. We've actually just grown. We keep growing. It turns into a family. But I'm only asking you this because obviously when it comes to what I've just started doing, you've been doing for a while.
We want to follow you. I don't know why we're talking about your business.
I want to know what
why
you look
for.
Why are
we talking about your business?
Because
whatever he does.
I want to understand why and how you...
Do you own part of Spotify? I still can't get past this.
A little bit.
That's crazy.
I used to own more. I sold most of it a few years ago.
Crazy. That's amazing.
Do you have a mansion?
Well, I don't know about mansion.
Do you only
like men with mansions?
Yeah.
That's fair.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Me too.
Yeah.
No, I never cared about money.
Good.
I really didn't.
What do you look for? How do you know if something's going to hit or miss?
You know, I think the biggest thing is we call the system capitalism, but it's really consumerism. And what I mean by that is the consumer always wins.
Yep.
So, what does modern society allow you to do? Well, if you're a consumer with money, whatever you want. So it all comes down to understanding what people's needs are, where
sex
there's demand trade. For something. Definitely. That's forever.
It's huge. Yeah.
Huge. And, with something like Spotify, that demand was a little bit invisible. You know, no one was out there saying, oh, I wish I had a streaming music service. But you can sort of use your imagination to say, well, if this thing existed, I think everyone would use it.
Yeah.
I'll give you a crazy example. Now most of what I do is in healthcare. So we'll see what you think of this, Caroline. You've got how many kids?
A thousand?
You're going to say 1,000?
You almost said 1,000. Is that what it feels like?
Yeah.
Everyone else is answering for me. I had to think about that for a minute. I've got three.
You got three
children,
kids.
People.
Okay. So here's a crazy bet of mine. Here's a crazy 10-year bet. You know, I don't know if this is going to be a business anytime soon, but let's use our imagination. I think that if you look at what really rich people do, it's a good sign of what everyone is going to do in the future, because rich people have the most freedom, right? They can do as close to what they want as anyone. Yep. So right now, I see a lot of rich people using surrogates.
A lot.
Okay. Now, what does that tell me? It tells me that a lot of women, if they had the choice, would rather they didn't have to carry. So here's a crazy bet. Here's
An
a crazy
app,
bet.
A surrogate app.
Artificial wombs. Now, this is something, it's going to take us a while to get that science. But let me tell you, one of the biggest opportunities in the future is whoever creates the first artificial womb that allows you to incubate babies without having to carry them, trust me, women are going to do it.
Stop.
Well, it's going to take a while, but we're looking. We look. So we have crazy ideas
like
this.
Do you have like a team that does this with
Absolutely.
You?
Absolutely.
Okay. This is amazing.
Would you given the choice... it's Terminator. Was a movie where they're all in these wombs.
I actually would, because I got very sick. I almost died twice in childbirth. So, because I get preeclampsia every time.
Right.
So they actually don't want me to have any more babies. So I would be the perfect candidate for this, not just because I don't want my body ravaged, but because I actually really have to. You know, it's very dangerous for me to have a baby. And it's very, you know... So for all different reasons, it can be for, lots of models don't want babies because it, what it does to their stomach and everything else.
Well, and that's our key market. We always start by asking, what do models need right now? And then,
100%, that's what I do.
What's a good
what when, models want?
When you wake up in the morning and ask that question, good things happen.
Yeah, make it for the models.
That's right, yeah. Exactly.
I get what you're saying there. That would be obviously a huge market.
Yeah, but I feel like we've given something away. Should we delete this part?
Well, you're gonna make it.
Yes.
Well, I think this is the kind of idea.
Yes, I actually want to make an official
we'll be lucky if I see this idea happen in my lifetime.
Sure.
But if I go on your radio show and some young enterprising people in the Emirates hear about it, they might be the ones who invent it. So you got to have a big vision that's very futuristic, and then you wait around until you see brilliant people who are entrepreneurs come up with awesome stuff. Spotify wasn't my idea. Some other guys had, and they did a beautiful job executing it. All I had to do was see it. And so we just spend a lot of time learning and waiting around until people do brilliant things.
Yeah, it's crazy. Juju, could you pass me that book up there?
But to come into something like that, like as an initial investor, how much do you have to put into like companies like this?
Well, I don't know. I mean, I wouldn't know.
You can start small.
You can.
This is a book. I was honored to meet Mark Randolph and hang out with him for a while, right? Cool. And he sent me this book. This is the guy that created Netflix, right? Mm. Or co-founded Netflix.
Mm-hmm.
And
he's having a bromance. He's like,
I love that.
Yeah. Look, he wrote me a
whole. Has he been on the podcast?
No, not yet.
Can I read the inscription?
Yeah.
Read that.
You want me to read it out loud?
Yeah, read it out loud. Yeah, give me some praise. That's amazing.
Oh my God.
For Chris, the one guy who has probably heard that will never work even more than I have.
Is that true? Well,
yeah. You hear that a lot?
All the time.
Congrats on all your success, which I can attest to in this beautiful home. And thanks for showing everyone that with creativity, hard work, and persistence, that yes, you can make it work. See you again soon.
Yeah, cool.
Well, so when did you see him last?
I saw him in the Maldives. We spent a couple of days.
Wow.
He was
Was that his vacation or what?
He was actually speaking at a seminar that I was speaking at, right?
Tony Robbins or something?
He wasn't there, but Tony was here a couple of weeks ago.
Wow. He brought Tony on stage. Chris is actually quite a big deal here.
Oh, you're going to be nice now?
No, only for a minute. It's okay. Over.
It's funny because when you go to other places, you never know who's famous.
Yeah.
Right? And it's like, you know, I'm here, we're hanging out in your living room, and I'm probably going to go back and tell people I did this. Like, oh my God, did you touch him? Did you save some saliva?
Yeah.
Or something?
Yeah,
you know?
No, don't save his saliva.
No, I can if you like.
I'd like to get a vial to go back to the States
with. Put that inside the womb that you create at some stage.
Exactly. No, but the one thing, actually, we did a podcast earlier about like anxiety and things and like getting to where we are. And the one thing I always say to you is, like, he's a single dad.
Chris?
Two gorgeous girls that live here with him. And he does an amazing, like,
immaculate conception.
Yeah.
That's great.
That's right.
He has an artificial womb.
That's fabulous.
If only. But listen, the thing about this, that the reason why I brought this in, because I was having the same conversation about with Mark about how I said to him, how did you come up with it? And he just said, it's about finding what people want and then just giving them what they need.
Yeah.
And he knew that he was sitting at home wanting to watch more movies and he wanted to send them out on a VHS tape back then. But he just said, it's really trying to find what humans want and then just giving them what they want.
Do you remember going down to Blockbuster and choosing that movie, taking hours? I actually quite missed that. It was such a thing to do with all your friends. But now you lie in bed and you've got all the movies in front of you.
You've got every option.
Every option.
I mean, and I'll tell you,
Were you ever told by anyone, what are you doing? Like, why are you trying to do this?
Always. Anything, I'm someone, I think it's why I became an artist, I'm someone who is most comfortable when everyone disagrees with me.
Oh, really?
That's fun for me. I like arguing something that I think is right when everyone thinks the other thing.
What's your biggest failure?
My biggest failure?
Anything you invested in that you really thought was going to go hit?
Because that's what they say, that you never hear, and he was saying the same thing.
Yeah.
You'd invest in so many. You only hear about the ones that...
You only hear about the winners.
Well, you don't hear about the table farm that we decided to grow tables that no one wanted. Like, is there anything that you put money into or that just didn't kick?
Oh, absolutely. You know, we just had a company die, and that's one of the saddest parts of the business. We had a company die that I invested in 7 years ago.
Yeah.
It was one of my first things. I was really passionate about it. It was a company that was making healthy snacks. So this is when I started getting interested in human health. They were making really healthy snacks.
God, just don't go there.
In the US.
Chris Faye does.
I've got my own healthy snack company.
You do?
Yeah. So why did it go under? Can we get some of my snacks, please?
It's called Fade Fit Kids.
We're a year and a half in. We're doing well. But just tell me, this is. I thought you were joking for a moment.
You really want to know?
No. I thought you told me.
No. This is a prank.
Oh, this is no joke. So you really want to know?
Yeah.
So what you've got going on right now in the world is there are a lot of big, old companies in old, established industries, like food.
Yep, Mars,
Nestle,
Pepsi,
Mars, Procter & Gamble, all these big, old companies.
Yeah.
And you've got a younger generation of consumer that doesn't care about those old brands. They don't care about Ruffles. They don't care about Pringles. They want to try something new. Let me see this.
This is only one of our SKUs.
Oh, I mean, this is a big hit.
So this is my kids are on there. It's my kids. One's the general manager and the other one's a financial controller, and that's me. But
this is awesome.
Yeah, I want you to
are
try.
Are your muscles really like
try
not
it.
As big as that anymore?
I'm going to definitely try this.
I will try them off the podcast, and I want to show you more. I'll talk to you more about it.
So here's why it failed.
Okay.
These big companies are desperate for innovation. Yep. So you start a brand like Fade Fit Kids.
Yeah.
Okay. And it gets really popular, gets really big. All the grocery stores want it. I believe this is going to happen with you.
This is already there.
It's already happening, okay?
We're in 400 locations now.
So it's all over. And now what happens is hopefully...
Someone get him a tissue, he's sweating.
Procter & Gamble calls. Chris, I love what you've done. Yep. You've blown this up. You're using your social media presence. You're using your radio show. We can't do marketing like this. We want to buy the brand. And they go, Chris, we want to give you $50 million.
Yep.
And... sometimes the genius move is to say, get lost.
Okay, yes.
I'm going for another 10 years.
Yep.
But in this industry, sometimes the genius move is to take the money when it's hot.
Oh, he's always going to say, take the money.
Yeah.
And I'll tell you, this company that we looked at, the guys behind it, they thought they were going to be the biggest thing ever. They didn't sell when they should have.
Because there are some big snack brands coming out of the States. There's the Kind Bar.
That's
right. You know, Be Kind.
Yeah.
They're great.
I'm so hungry.
Now, we're 14 months in. I've already had those names.
Right.
I've already sat in boardroom meetings and they've been discussing this.
Yeah.
The discussion hasn't come of here's a check,
yep.
But they're on that length of we love what you're doing. And I've had the same conversation with friends and, you know, people, my work colleagues, and, you know, where I've said, if a decent amount was offered, you know, yes, I'd probably say, great, this is what I wanted. I wanted it started. But that's interesting. So they had to close because you thought that they should have taken the cash earlier.
Well, what happened is when they didn't take the cash, those big companies just copied their product.
Yeah.
And then they were competing with a giant.
Yeah, you can't compete against the big boys. Yep.
Now, you know, I don't think anyone will be able to compete with this. It's so weird, so unique.
Yeah.
Kids are involved in it. Yeah. There's something special there. But still... the category is something you can't own forever.
Well, that is your difference. That is your point of difference. But that's a good thing and it's a bad thing.
Yeah.
Because when you're selling a product like that and it's your face,
yeah,
then someone to take it over, it's difficult because it's not.
Well, then you stay on. I mean, if it ever happened, for example, we got interest in the States for my snack.
Yeah.
So we got FDA approval on it.
Oh, nice.
But then the first thing, if you look at the package, they see me on there and they were like, who are the two girls are great, but who's the weird muscly man on the packet? Can we get rid of it?
So
we have new packaging coming out, which
without
I'll show you. Without me.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well, so that's an example though of a mature move on your part.
Yeah.
You know, you saw that and you said, makes sense.
Yeah.
You know, if you're an egomaniac, you might have insisted on that, blown up the deal. So that's part of it. When we look for entrepreneurs, you're looking for people who have this unusual degree of self-confidence. They're taking the risk to start something. They want to go the distance. They're not going and taking a normal job. But at the same time, they have to be self-aware enough that when they see great opportunity, they take it. When someone says, you got to take your face off the package, it doesn't make sense here, they do it.
Yeah.
So it sounds like you're well on your way.
Well, this is good. Okay, enough about
me. I'm in.
You're in?
Yes. I'm in.
Can we go back to the rock band?
Yeah.
What did you do in the rock? What were you playing?
I was a singer.
Oh,
so it was me and one other guy, and we would write the songs together. I'd write the melodies and the lyrics, and then I was the singer. And then after the band...
I want to hit something.
Yeah, okay. Let's.
Oh, that's easy.
Can we insert some right now into this podcast, please?
Done.
Yeah.
Okay, now we
that's
can actually
good, yeah.
have a listen to it.
Yeah,
because so
I'm fascinated.
On YouTube, I'm guessing, or Spotify?
Yeah, I mean, you can go to Spotify.
Okay, this is Brianna, by the way.
Okay. Hey, what's up, Brianna? I'm gonna take this opportunity to
eat it.
So they're my. I'll talk to you about what I've got, like, because they're changing. We're changing the packaging. French. What was it? The band's name?
Chester French, and the most well known song is called "She Loves Everybody."
It comes up first.
Yeah.
Only 1.8 million views, goddamn you.
Oh my God, look at you.
Yeah, sorry, I don't have a Spotify here. No sugar in those.
Wow. Love that.
Super cool, man.
I love it. It's very sort of like...
Mm. UMG on behalf of the Neptunes.
I'm about to get to the chorus.
Yeah. We need the chorus.
She creeps a mansion.
Creeps tension, not mansion.
I mansion. I thought it was a mansion.
So fun. How many songs did you release?
Well, we put out 3 albums, and
I
made a solo album.
So cool.
My solo album was the last thing I put out. But then this year, a song I made a couple years ago, they used it in the new Fast and the Furious movie. So it was on the soundtrack of that like a couple months ago.
God damn, man.
Like,
Hobbs and Shaw.
You're making me feel like an underachiever.
Okay, so now we've just heard it.
Yeah, you can play the Hobbs and Shaw one. That's the newest one that we put out. That's me singing. It's totally different.
Okay, we'll play the Hobbs and Shaw one instead of that one. I want to play
you
that.
You can, yeah, whatever.
Okay, we'll come back at it. Very, very cool. Very, I don't even know what type of music do you even call that?
Well, we always thought the goal was if Outkast and the Beatles had a baby. That was the goal.
I agree. It was, even the music video clip was a bit like, it was, you know, black and white sort of feel. It was the Beatles. No, ever any want or need to go back into the music industry?
Well, I mean, I think as I told you, Caroline, we you know, you make music and you put it out there in the world and then randomly stuff happens with it. So this year we had this big surprise, which was a song I made with another friend, not Chester French, a different project that they put on the new Fast and Furious soundtrack. So I didn't even hear about it until the movie was released and someone called me. You know, you get emails saying, hey, someone wants to use it for this, that, or the other. And sometimes if you got a busy day, I'll just say, yeah, sure, whatever. So I didn't even notice what it was going to be. Someone said Hobbs and Shaw. I didn't know that was Fast and Furious.
The Rock, yeah.
And then, you know, it was the biggest movie of the summer in the U.S.
That's crazy.
So, you know, occasionally when you're a musician, you put stuff out there and randomly it pops up in the world. And then in the middle of it, the other musical thing I did, I don't think I told you about this, but I had a film role. So I've acted one time.
I was in La La Land. Yes,
yeah,
you did.
And the movie won a bunch of Oscars.
Yeah.
We're doing not enough, Chris.
So the only movie I've ever been in was in La La Land.
Well, because since it won all the Oscars, I have to wait for another one that has that kind of potential. You know, I don't want to be in a movie that doesn't win Oscars now.
Look at you. You've set that bar so
it's very high.
Spotify the Oscars. I think we should just go home. You're making us feel very inadequate.
Well, it's all downhill from here.
Well, for us.
No, well, for me.
I've got a snack company which supposedly is going to go bankrupt, maybe.
No, I love it. Sure. We're going down together in the snack company, if anything.
Well, listen, man. What brought you to Dubai? Why are you here? We didn't even ask that question.
Well, you know, as I said, now I do a lot of stuff in healthcare. So the problems I'm trying to solve right now are problems in medicine. Because as you know, everyone in their family has someone with cancer or heart disease or neurodegenerative, you know, Alzheimer's, dementia.
Yep.
So I've now fixed my attention on trying to solve those problems. How do we develop new types of medicine to make this one part of our lives that is terrible for everyone a little bit better? And I think over here in Dubai and Abu Dhabi, I was in Saudi last week, there's so much potential because the societies are changing so quickly. So I think we got to think globally today as investors or just as people, or if we're in culture, if we're artists. And it was important for me to come over here, see what people are doing in healthcare to figure out if there are ways that as an investor, I can have an impact on people globally. And this is such an interesting moment for you guys here in the region. You know, things just seem like they're changing at such a fast pace. I said to a friend the other day, feels like the whole region is a startup. And I love that. And that energy inspires me. So
true.
It's been really fun. And then, you know, obviously you get to meet people. That's always a treat. And
did you introduce him to Michael and MC?
Michael's unfortunately in London, but I'm going to set a call for him.
Cool.
Yeah, 100%. Yeah, that's really interesting. You say that this region is like a startup. It is. It is like you can come to this city, for example, Dubai, go to Abu Dhabi, go to Saudi, which is popping right now.
Poppin'.
And if you have an idea, if you have a vision, you can really create it, you know, right here. And people are, and things can happen a lot quicker. It's if you know someone that knows this person, the next thing you know, it's rolling and you're like, wow, this.
And let me say, just to be blunt about it, you know, there's a lot of racism in the West about this part of the world. And in spite of the fact that everyone has the internet, everyone should be able to see what's going on in real time. I had to come see it with my own eyes, even in Saudi. You know, you'd think there's just all this brutality and whatever. And I get over there and it's like this energy and people are excited and things are changing. I think about in the U.S., nothing's changing. Everyone's frustrated. It feels like we're stuck. And to see that kind of transformation in real time, it just proved to me that people really got to get out of their own bubbles. They got to get down into the streets, meet people, ask them directly, one-on-one, from person to person, what's going on.
Yep.
And what I've seen over here is so inspiring to me. It's just so much energy.
So cool, man, Carolina. Like we say that as well. We obviously back home in the UK, you know, so many people in the States. I know people back home, Australia. You know, they say
I'm
Dubai.
I'm very inspired here.
What's that?
I get inspired here every day.
But what you're saying is that you've got to come down, like people, you know, oh, you live in Dubai, you lot of hold hands. What do you wear at the beach? Are you, what, like, you need to come and see the city and you need to be like, whoa, this is what it's all about. This is real.
Well, everyone here to me is a cowboy, a renegade, a rebel. They all left somewhere else to come here because they had a dream they were chasing.
That's what I said to everyone. I'm like, this place was 45 years old.
Right.
Look around you people.
Yeah,
so true.
You know, look around. When you understand that concept, you understand how fast paced it is. And as I said, from being here, you know, like look at the things like even I've achieved in 3 years in this country.
Yeah. Well, you're on a couch with him.
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, come on.
Trying to get off this couch.
This is the peak of your career. Just know that.
It's all downhill.
This has been really cool. This has been a very interesting chat. And hopefully if you come back to the region, we'll get you back on and find out what's been happening. Yeah.
Anytime.
I know. You're making us really think. Like we need to speak to you. We want to know what you're investing in next because we've got a few pennies we'd like to put 100%. In it.
Artificial wombs.
Yeah.
We're down. If let's someone was creating out of it, I would go, you know what?
I'm in.
Give me a little bit of cash.
I'm all in.
I'll barter it. I'll promote it on my Instagram. Yeah. Just give me some. again, thank you so much for coming through. And we really appreciate
fascinating.
It.
Great hanging, guys.
Absolutely fascinating. You've got to come back. I've given me so much. My head is spinning, actually. I feel totally inadequate and I want to do more now.
Well, that's
likewise.
What
I want to eat some of these dates.
Come on, get some of my snacks.
It's so good.
It's Chris and Caroline's Not So Epic podcast. Shoot us the messages. Share it with your friends. Thank you for subscribing. And thank you for just like us listening and watching today.
I've had a great day.
I've been all right with you.
Yeah.
Bye.
Bye.
It's Chris Fade and Caroline Stabry's Not So Epic podcast.
Brought to you by NMC Healthcare and Cosmosurge. Head to cosmosurge.com.